Welcome to this video mini-lecture on female reproduction. We will be following the cyclic processes that leads to the generation of a mature ovum and potential fertilized egg, as well as the important structures that make up the female reproductive tract. My name is Christopher Demas, and I'll be walking you through these topics. One concept that will be important to keep in mind when learning about the female reproductive system is that the structures and histology of the female reproductive organs are not static, but are rather in flux and constantly changing in response to hormone levels within the female body. We will therefore be describing the histology of the female reproductive organs during this cyclic process and the important features during each cycle. We will start this illustration with the ovary. The ovary is an important structure since it contains the female gametes and is where an immature egg, or ovum, develops. Before we discuss the details of the ovary, I would like to point out that I'll be using the N and C notation here that will mirror what you've seen previously in your lectures and is the notation used on board exams. N stands for the number of chromosome sets, while C stands for the number of chromatids associated with each chromosome within the cell. Returning to the ovary, the immature egg starts as an oogonium, which is a diploid cell containing a full set of chromosomes with two chromatids for each chromosome, one being from mom and the other from dad. The oogonium is therefore designated 2N2C. The oogonium then matures into a larger structure that consists of a primordial follicle surrounding a primary oocyte. You might be wondering, what is the difference between a follicle and an oocyte? This is a great question and an area of confusion for many students. A follicle is the supporting structures within the ovary that contains one oocyte, which is the developing ovum. The follicle and oocyte mature together in the ovary and have named stages of maturation that at times do not align in the way that you might think. I will first describe the stages of development and structure of a follicle within the ovary that contains a maturing oocyte. The primordial follicle mentioned before is composed of flat squamous-type follicular cells, which mature into a primary follicle. The primary follicle is larger than the primordial follicle and can be recognized by its 1 to 2 layers of cuboidal epithelium. The primary follicle continues to grow and develop, forming a secondary follicle. The secondary follicle contains a clustering of internal cells known as the granulosa cells, and fluid-filled spaces within the follicle called antral spaces. In addition, two outer layers of the secondary follicle become viewable, called the internal and external theca layers. The secondary follicle continues to grow, and once the antral spaces coalesce to form a single fluid-filled pouch, the follicle has reached its mature form, which is adequately named a mature follicle. Within the mature follicle, the remaining granulosa cells that surround the oocyte are a structure known as the corona radiata, and the stalk of cells anchoring the oocyte to the follicle wall is known as the cumulus oophorus. The mature follicle, like the secondary follicle, also contains a prominent internal and external theca layer. During this entire process of follicle maturation, the oocyte remains within the primary oocyte stage of development. That means even though the follicle is progressing through these series of developmental stages, the oocyte remains in the primary oocyte stage as shown here. The primary oocyte contains two sets of chromosomes and replicated sister chromatids, meaning its chromosome number is 2 and its chromatid number is 4. During this phase, the primary oocyte enters the first stage of gamete formation, meiosis I. However, it doesn't finish since the immature oocyte becomes arrested in prophase I, where it remains diploid. At the time of birth, all of the oocytes in the ovaries are primary oocytes that are arrested in this stage of development. It isn't until puberty that meiosis I resumes. During each menstrual cycle, a small number of primary oocytes and their accompanying follicle mature and the oocyte completes meiosis I right before ovulation, resulting in the formation of a secondary oocyte. The secondary oocyte continues into meiosis II and then is arrested in metaphase II. Since the secondary oocyte has completed meiosis I, the genetic information has been reduced by half, meaning the secondary oocyte would be 1N2C in comparison to the 2N4C that was the primary oocyte. This transition from primary to secondary oocyte occurs right before the oocyte is released from the mature follicle during ovulation. Upon release from the secondary oocyte from the follicle, the empty follicle becomes a structure known as the corpus luteum. The corpus luteum is an important structure involved in secreting progesterone, which would prepare the uterus for implantation of a fertilized egg. If fertilization does not occur, the corpus luteum degenerates into a dense collagenous scar called the corpus albicans and appears pink on H&E stain. Following ovulation, the secondary oocyte is collected and guided by fimbria into the fallopian tube and propelled towards the uterus. Let's take a quick look at the histology of the fallopian tube. On cross-section, the central part of the fallopian tube contains many plicae within its structure, as shown here. These projections sweep the secondary oocyte towards the uterus. If sperm enters the female tract and reaches the oocyte in the fallopian tube, the sperm cell will penetrate the outer coating of the secondary oocyte. This will initiate the oocyte to complete meiosis II, forming the mature haploid ovum, prior to fusion of the sperm with the ovum's genetic information to form a diploid zygote. The next structure in the female reproductive system is the uterus, which is a pear-shaped organ with an endometrium, or uterine lining, and myometrium, or smooth muscle layer. The endometrial layer is a dynamic tissue that responds to the fluctuating hormone levels produced mainly by the ovary to prepare for a potential pregnancy. There are three cyclic uterine phases that occur simultaneously with the ovary processes discussed previously: the proliferative phase, secretory phase, and menstrual phase. You should be able to recognize the histology of the proliferative and secretory phase, however, you should not worry about the histology of the menstrual phase for this course. The proliferative phase is defined by a shallow proliferating endometrium with tubular glands open to the surface. The proliferative phase occurs during the simultaneous development of the oocyte, and this phase ends with the release of the secondary oocyte during ovulation. For this reason, the proliferative phase is on top to remind you of the connection between the oocyte development and the ovary, while the endometrium is proliferating. The secretory phase is defined by a thick endometrium with glands that have become highly coiled and filled with secretions such as glycoproteins and glycogen. The thickness of the endometrium is in fact at its maximum during this time. The secretory phase occurs while the corpus luteum secretes progesterone and ends if there is no fertilization, which leads to the degeneration of the corpus luteum into the corpus albicans. There are two other areas that you should be able to recognize, such as the epithelia of the cervix and the vagina. The cervix is a structure found in the inferior aspects of the uterus and consists of an outer portion called the ectocervix and an inner portion called the endocervix. There is a sharp transition between the outer and inner cervix, called the transformation zone, which can be easily seen on an H&E stained slide. The endocervix contains a simple columnar glandular epithelium, which can be seen on the right, and the ectocervix contains a stratified squamous epithelium, shown on the left. Finally, the vagina is covered by stratified squamous epithelium that is similar to the ectocervix. It also displays a prominent smooth muscle layer. At the distal end of the vagina, the mucosa gradually transitions into the epidermis of the skin that covers the external genitalia. We have covered a lot of information in this mini lecture, and I think it would be a good idea to take a moment to review the important topics. We started by following the maturation of an oocyte into an ovum and investigated the developmental stages of the follicle that support the immature egg. Make sure to review the major histological features of the follicle as it develops and know the labeled features as part of each stage. The oocyte also matures and undergoes two rounds of meiosis in order to become a mature haploid ovum. Recall the N and C notation, with N standing for the number of chromosome sets and C for the number of copies of each chromatid. I recommend that you commit to memory the genetic content in terms of N and C, since this tends to be important for your understanding of oogenesis, and are topics potentially tested on board exams. As a quick review, the oogonium starts as a diploid cell with 2N, 2C. The chromatids are replicated, forming the primary oocyte with 2N, 4C. The primary oocyte is arrested in prophase 1 until puberty, and then during each menstrual cycle, a few primary oocytes continue to form secondary oocytes. The secondary oocytes are formed right before ovulation. Secondary oocytes continue into meiosis II, however, are arrested in metaphase of meiosis II. Following ovulation, the empty follicle becomes a corpus luteum and secretes progesterone to prepare the uterus for pregnancy. If pregnancy doesn't occur, this structure degenerates to form a corpus albicans. However, if fertilization does occur, the secondary oocyte completes meiosis II and becomes a haploid ovum with 1N, 1C, prior to fusion with the haploid sperm, which is also 1N, 1C, to become a diploid zygote, 2N, 2C. In addition, during this lecture, we discussed the important histological elements of the various structures within the female reproductive tract, such as the fallopian tube with the fimbriae and plicae, the uterus, cervix, and vagina. We reviewed the structural patterns of the endometrium of the uterus and how these stages are coordinated with developmental stages within the ovary. Make sure to review the important structures of the endometrium during the proliferative and secretory stages and how it relates to stages of development within the ovary. For example, the endometrium is proliferating while the follicle develops, and after ovulation, which is during the formation of a corpus luteum, the secretory stage occurs within the uterus. Within the cervix, recall the sharp transition between the columnar epithelium of the endocervix and the stratified squamous epithelium of the ectocervix, called the transformation zone. Finally, remember how the vagina is lined with stratified squamous cells. Thank you again for watching, and I hope you found this video to be helpful.